Yes, ma'am, you can start, please.
Good afternoon to one and all, and welcome to the second session of international webinar on sensor and its application. Let us now begin the session with the invocation of God's blessings through the prayer song. Today, we have for the second session, the resource person, Dr. Dhayal Raj, Assistant Professor, Sirat College, Tirupathur, to address the gathering on metal oxides on gas sensors. It is my immense pleasure to extend my warm welcome to the resource person, Dr. A. Dhayal Raj, for the international webinar on sensors and its application on behalf of the Department of Physics, Auxilium College. I deem it a great privilege to introduce him to all who have gathered here at this platform. Dr. Dhayal Raj, a youthful and renowned professor from Sirat College, Tirupathur, has completed his bachelor's degree course in physics at Sirat College, Tirupathur in 2002 and came out as a gold medalist, scoring 95.8% and continued his master's degree in BSG College, Coimbatore, completing it with distinction. Right away, with the desire to pursue higher education, he registered in Bharatiya University for PhD and awarded doctorate degree in 2010 for the dissertation of his research on preparation, characterization, and sensitivity measurements on vanadium pentoxide nanostructured powders and thin films. He began his teaching career at Bharatiya University as a guest lecturer for a few months and then as assistant professor in Karunya University in 2010 for less than a year. And thereafter, he joined Sirat College, Tirupathur in July 2011 and remained as dedicated professor to this day. He has a great interest in research, which was very vivid in his achievements over a short period of time. He has one patent for his credit, titled as Smart and Automatic Electric Bill Generation Using Internet of Things, created in January 2018. His papers are published in 61 international journals and 15 in national journals and 101 in international conferences and 85 in national conferences. He is serving the institute, teaching both UG and PG courses and promoting research scholars in the departments. He had guided 28 students for MPhil research and continues to guide the present students for completing the projects. Two scholars have completed their PhD under his able guidance. Four scholars are pursuing their doctorate under his guidance. At this juncture, I'm also happy and proud to be a student for pursuing my doctorate. I just want to bring to light the awards and fellowships he had obtained for this academic, in his academic excellence. As I had mentioned earlier, he's a gold medalist in BSc Physics and obtained Junior Research Fellowship in Defensive Research and Development Organization sponsored research project offered by CSIR and the UGC from May 2006 to August 2009. He was also selected for Graduate Student Exchange Program sponsored by the Government of Canada from September 2009 to February 2010. Besides, he has won Best Oral Presentation and Best Poster Presentation awards in national and international conferences. During his years of career, he had indeed excellent research experience as he had worked as a junior research fellow for the sponsored research project entitled Fabrication of Nanostructured Thin Films for Microfabricated Gas Sensors to Assess the Quality of Food Products such as Meat and Milk under Dr. D. Mangal Raj, Project Director, Professor and Head, Department of Nanoscience and Technology, Bharatiya University, Tamil Nadu. He also worked in the preparation of nanostructured thin films with hot filament chemical vapor deposition method at the University of Saskatchewan, Canada, for a period of 6 months from September 2009 to February 2010. He has worked on saturated absorption spectroscopy under the guidance of Dr. Hema Ramachandran, Associate Professor at C.V. Raman Research Institute, Bangalore, during summer training program. Apart from this, he had been trained to work in X-ray absorption spectroscopy using synchrotron energy from Canadian light source, synchrotron in Canada. It is very evident Dr. Dhayal Raj has achieved remarkably over a short period and has a long way to go to accomplish all that he desires so as to contribute his best to the scientific society. A hearty welcome to you, sir. Now, over to you, sir.
Thank you, sister. Thank you for your warm words of welcome. Let me share my screen. A warm good afternoon to everyone present here. I'm going to discuss about metal oxide gas sensors in today's session. The outline of my talks is presented here. First of all, let us understand what is a sensor and a gas sensor. Then what is the need for a gas sensor? Then applications of gas sensor in day-to-day life, wherever it is applicable. Then what are the different types of gas sensors available in the market? What is nano? Then finally, need for nanostructured gas sensors. Why nanostructures are very much attractive to prepare a gas sensor? Let's see one by one. First of all, what is a sensor? So the pictures here is well known to you. A temperature gun, which you come across whenever you go for a shopping complex or malls or hospitals or even in railway stations and airports, you can see these guns. Even in colleges, they use. Whenever you enter a college, come out, checking your temperature in this pandemic situation. And also thermometers to check your body temperature, especially for children or adults, whatever it may be. Then you have smartphones. Literally each and every one of us had a smartphone where it has a touch sensor and fingerprint sensors and so on. So first of all, we should know what is a sensor. A sensor is a device that detects or senses some kind of signal. It can be any physical stimuli for that matter. It can be heat or pressure or motion or touch or light, anything.
Sorry to interrupt you, sir.
Please.
Sir, there was a noise of air. I think you're breathing or fan somewhere.
Okay.
Not sure whether it's your breathing. Maybe you can put down your headset and you can try, sir. And let you know.
Okay.
I mean, yeah, the pace is being. Yes. Now you can try, sir.
Yeah. Am I audible now? Is it clear? I switched off the fan.
This is clear now, sir.
Okay. Please, fine.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, a sensor is a device that detects the signal, any kind of physical stimuli. It can be heat, sound, or light, or pressure for that matter. It can be anything. So keeping that in mind, that definition in mind, let us look at the sensors in day-to-day life, what we are using. So here you can see a watch where there is a touch screen sensor. And in a car, you have both in front and rear, you have infrared sensors to avoid accidents. You have a tap wherein you have motion sensors. So when you wave your hand underneath the tap, the sensor here, it will automatically recognize you and automatically water falls. And when you remove your hand, when there is no motion, automatically the water flow is cut off. Similarly, the similar principle is used for a sanitizer box or a soap solution box wherever it is necessary. And also, you have a fingerprint sensor in a locus. And also, you can see a fingerprint sensor in your smartphones. And even nowadays in colleges, they ask you to enter the attendance via fingerprints. Next, we will move on to the various parts within a sensor device. So as displayed here, the essential parts are sensing element, transducer, amplifier, processor, and display unit. So first one is the sensing element. It is nothing but the element which recognizes or senses the physical stimuli. As I told you earlier, it can be heat or pressure or motion, anything. So the element which senses that particular physical stimuli is called a sensing element. The signal obtained must be translated or converted into electrical output so that it can be amplified, because the signal will be very feeble. So you need a transducer. So a transducer is a device that converts the physical stimuli signal into an electrical signal. The electrical signal is fed to an amplifier. We have an op-amp amplifier here, which increases the strength of the signal to many folds. Then it is given to a processor, where the analog signal achieved is converted into digital signal. This digital signal is fed to the display, and we can read out the digital display. So next we'll move on to gas sensors. So as the name suggests, this particular sensor is going to sense the nature and concentration of gas in its vicinity. So when the gas molecules interact with the surface of the sensing element, there is some kind of change, that may be a resistance change or a change in the current in the device, or a potentiometric change, or any change for that kind. So depending on the variation in the change, measuring the amount of change, we can interpret the concentration of gas in the vicinity. So here are a few examples of gas sensors. You can see a fire alarm or a smoke sensor, which is available in most of the shopping malls and hospitals. And here you can see a gas sensor testing the leakage in pipes used for transporting gases. And you have a LPG sensor, which can be fixed to your LPG gas cylinder in your home to avoid any accidents. And here it is shown a breath sensor or an alcohol sensor. Whenever you travel in bike, sometimes at night, police stop you and ask you to blow against this device. And it measures the amount of alcohol or water, unwanted signals in your breath. Next is the importance of a gas sensor. Okay, why we should know really the use of gas sensor. Okay, I'm pretty sure that we all sleep well at night, don't we? Okay, so a minimum of 6 to 8 hours of sleep is required for each and every one of us. Even a well-grown adult needs a 6 hours of sleep, deep sleep. Whereas if they are kids, at least 8 hours of deep sleep is recommended. But my case, here the question is how you sleep during night. Okay, whether you are sleeping in a closed room or an open room. That is the next question. My parents and my grandparents would tell me to keep the windows wide open so that there will be a lot of air circulation. They used to tell us that you will have a better health when there is air circulation inside the room where you are sleeping. But nowadays, I don't know, maybe because of the theft reasons or because we are seeking comfortability, we always try to close up all the windows and doors of our house. And moreover, we prefer to stay inside an air conditioner room where I have seen people going and closing even the small passage underneath their door. They used to keep a mat and close that also to ensure the chillness doesn't escape anywhere. So in that case, you must be double the time careful, because while you are sleeping, there may be power cuts, because in an air conditioner, you have all kind of sensor, and also air is being continuously circulated. When there is a power cut, then the room, the atmosphere inside the room gets closed. And as you well know that we breathe in oxygen and give out carbon dioxide. In day-to-day life, everyone is unknowingly doing that. But though we have carbon dioxide around us, we have never felt the uneasiness or difficulty in breathing carbon dioxide. But when you are inside a closed room, it matters a lot. So I am taking carbon dioxide as an example. Let us see the ill effects of carbon dioxide when you are exposed at a higher concentration for a longer time. So inside a room, within the atmosphere, if the percentage of carbon dioxide is less than 0.035%, then you don't have any noticeable change. It is normal. But when the concentration increases to 3.3% to 5.4%, and if you are exposed for nearly 15 minutes, you find difficulty in breathing. Whereas if the concentration is still increased to 7.5% for over 15 minutes, then you have a lot of symptoms. You sweat like anything, you become restless, your head starts aching, you have an increased pulse rate, and so on. If the concentration is only 3%, but the exposure time is extended to 15 hours, then you may end up with decreased night vision or decrease in color sensitivity. Whereas if the concentration is as high as 10%, and if you're exposed to only just 1.5 minutes, your eyes starts flickering. There is an increased muscle activity, and also you end up in twitching. Twitching is nothing but jerking. Okay, your body is jerking. So if it crosses 10%, then if you are exposed for 15 minutes, totally you lose your consciousness. You just faint. And if it crosses 30%, it goes to the severe effects, and even some deaths have occurred. Okay, so even the carbon dioxide, which is surrounding us, also is effective. So we actually need a gas sensor to test the atmosphere in which we are living. Let us see where the gas sensors are used in a house. So within a house, we are using so many gas sensors without knowing. So we'll go one by one. So automatic fan ventilators. So whenever the surrounding atmosphere is bad, automatically it switches on. So in that particular ventilator, you have CO2 sensors and odor sensors. And as I mentioned you earlier, you need a LPG sensor to avoid accidents. In a combination oven, you have H2 sensors and humidity sensor. In dryers used for drying clothes and dryers in bathroom or dishwashers, you have humidity sensors to check whether the clothes or dishes are dry. In air conditioner, you have humidity sensor, CO sensor, air quality sensor, and odor sensors. So many sensors are inside an air conditioner. And in a fire alarm system, again, you have carbon monoxide sensors, H2 sensors, CH4 sensor, and garbage treatment system, you have, again, odor sensor and humidity sensor. So within the house itself, we are using so many gas sensors. Next, we'll move on to applications of gas sensors. So literally in most of the fields, we are using gas sensors. For example, in medical or clinical fields, whether it is military or agriculture or cosmetics or airline transportation, again in manufacturing and also in food and beverages, we are using gas sensors to test the quality of foods. Next, we'll move on to classification of gas sensors. As I told you earlier, there are lot many types of gas sensors available in the market. But before looking into the type of gas sensors, we should know about the bonding, different modes of bonding between a gas and solid material. So the first figure shows you physical adsorption. The word adsorption means just sitting on the surface of a solid material. So, for example, dust settles on the floor of our house or on the table when it is not used, right? So, when you wipe with a cloth, it goes away. So, this is called as physical adsorption. There is no bonding, there is no chemical reaction, nothing. So, the second one is chemisorption, wherein the gas molecules sit on the surface of the solid and they get bonded to the surface. There is a bonded chemical reaction takes place. And this is called as chemisorption. Whereas the third one is non-reversible reaction, that is absorption or diffusion. The gas molecule goes inside the surface of the solid and it is a non-reversible reaction and it stays there forever. Okay. Keeping in this mind, we'll move on to different types of gas sensors available. Okay. First one is electrochemical sensors. So here the change in current or voltage or capacitance or impedance is measured. Whereas in electrical sensors, the usually metal oxide sensors are used here widely. The resistivity or conductivity is measured. Electrolytic conductivity is measured. Heterojunction conductivity is also measured. For example, they prepare structures like a MOSFET or FET, and then they study the current output of these particular devices. Then we move on to mass sensitive sensors, wherein the change in weight or amplitude or frequency of vibration or the size is measured using a quartz crystal monitor and or a cantilever. And the output is converted into electrical signals. And you have magnetic gas sensors wherein the paramagnetic properties of the gas are tested. Then you have thermometric or calorimetric sensors wherein the very name suggests, right? Depends on heat, right? So the changes in temperature or heat flow, heat content, all those things, thermal conductivity, everything. By measuring these parameters, the concentration of gas and the type of gas can be known. And finally, you have optical devices. So optical phenomena comes into picture. The intensity or, of emission or intensity of absorption, reflectance, luminescence and refractive index, all these parameters come into play. By measuring all these parameters, again, you can test or you can predict the nature and amount of gas coming inside. So we'll go one by one. I'm giving just one example for each type of sensors. So in electrochemical sensor, As I told you earlier, the changes in current, voltage, capacitance or impedance is checked. So this is how the apparatus looks like. You have a electrolyte in between two sensing electrodes. So I have a one sensing electrode and one auxiliary electrode. In between, I have an electrolyte layer. And across this electrodes, I have an ammeter and voltmeter connected in order to check the voltage and current passing through. And this side, the other side of the sensing layer, I have a modifying layer or modifying coating. This ensures to interact with the gas molecules in a better way. So when the gas molecules enter the chamber, they tend to react with the modifying coating. This modifying coating ensures that the sensing electrode releases a hole into the electrolyte. At the same time, an electron is being circulated through the circuitry, external circuitry, and it results with the generation of current and voltage. So depending on the number of gas molecules reacting on the surface of the modifying coating, the current generation and voltage generation will vary. So depending on the amount of voltage generated, I can reversibly calculate the number of molecules that has entered or interacted with the modifying coating. This is how they calculate the concentration of the gas. Next is the optical device. So here, as I told you, we have so many parameters, emission, absorption, reflectance, so many parameters. Here I have chosen the absorption as a parameter. You can see here you have a chamber which is divided into two. So the sensing element is fixed in between, and you have a region here beneath that and a chamber on top wherein gas can be allowed inside and gas can be purged out. So a detailed diagram is given below. There is a separation. This red color line shows a separation between the two regions. On top region, the gas is circulated, whereas at bottom, either it is maintained in vacuum, or if you are going to use a carrier gas along with the test gas, you can store the carrier gas at the bottom so that when a light source is allowed, the light source is split into two with equal intensity. It tries to traverse this path. Okay, so on top side, it travels like this and reaches the detector. So when it is traveling inside the test gas, the gas molecules tend to absorb the energy of the light from the photons. The similar way, a portion of light with equal intensity is made to cross the bottom chamber also and reach the reference detector. So the difference between the two detectors is noted, and the difference is converted into a digital output and supplied to the output device. So depending on the difference, we can reversibly calculate the amount of concentration of gas that has entered this particular chamber. Next, we move on to mass sensitive sensors. So here the weight or amplitude or the frequency with which that vibrate. For example, in case of a cantilever, it vibrates. The vibrating frequency is noted. The change in frequency will give you the amount of gas that is deposited on the surface. So this particular kind of gas sensor, they use quartz crystal monitor or a cantilever to measure the concentration of the gas. So this is what we have. So this particular mass sensitive gas sensor works on the piezoelectric effect. So piezoelectric material are those material which generate electric charges when they are subjected to pressure or tension. As the diagram GIF file shows here, whenever it is compressed, there is a production of electric charge. Whenever it is pulled up, there is an opposite charge produced. So the needle falls off. Okay. So this particular principle is used here. So I have two types of test gases here. I can use any one of them, or if I want, I can use both of them simultaneously. I have a mass flow controller here to check how much gas I am inserting into this particular gas chamber. So the output of the gas chamber is given to a Keithley multimeter, where the resistivity changes or conductivity changes can be measured. And also, I have a temperature controller here. So the operating temperature of the sensing element can be varied or optimized. Okay. So inside this chamber, I have an arrangement like this. So I have a quartz crystal in between. The yellow layers on both sides are electrodes, okay, metal electrodes. On top of the metal electrodes, I have a sensing layer coating. So in this case, they are having ZNO sensing layers, and the gas molecule that comes in is NO2 gas molecules. So when the gas molecules enter the layer, they tend to get deposited on the ZNO films, making chemisorption. So when they sit on one side of the film, automatically there is a pressure produced. So even that is a minute pressure, the quartz crystal will show charge generation. So the frequency output really changes. So depending on the del F, that is change in mass, there is a frequency change, del F. That frequency change will be displayed in your output. And depending on the change in the frequency, you can calculate the amount of molecules that is interacting with the surface. Next, you have thermoelectric gas sensors. Here, the temperature or heat is involved. So the setup goes like this. And for this particular sensor, we are using the principle of Wheatstone's network. We have come across in our undergraduate level. In post office box, we are doing this particular what principle we are learning from post office box, which we have in undergraduate practicals. So the formula goes like that. You have four different resistors, P, Q, R, S. You have four different resistors. And when any one of the arm, the resistance in any one of the arm changes, automatically the galvanometer, which is in a balanced condition, which reads zero, automatically shifts. So depending on the needle change, you can say how much there is change in the resistance value. So the calculation goes like this. P by Q must be equal to R by S. So whenever there is a change in one particular resistance, then automatically the bridge loses its balance. So the same thing is applied here. I have four different resistors here. Two standard resistance, so box-like things. Maybe R1, R2. Here I have two coils, and these coils are special coils. They have temperature coefficient of resistance. It can be negative temperature of resistance, or it can be positive temperature coefficient of resistance. Never mind. But these coils are temperature coefficient of resistance coils, which means that whenever there is a change in the temperature surrounding the coil, okay, that coil, automatically the resistance of the coil changes. So in that case, you can see very well that in all of one side, I am allowing carrier gas alone, whereas in other side, I am allowing carrier gas along with test gas. So when the gas molecules come into contact with the wire, they automatically take away the heat energy from the wire. Automatically, the temperature changes, and the resistance also changes correspondingly. So if there are more number of gas molecules inside the chamber, there is a more resistance change. Whereas when there is a less number of gas molecules, less resistance change can be noticed. And that again, is represented by the misbalance in the Wheatstone's bridge. And that can be read with the output device. Next is the electrical gas sensors. This is what we are doing in our laboratory. So we have, we are preparing metal oxide layers, thin films and powders both. And we are testing the resistivity of the metal oxide layers. And we are counting the resistivity of the layer, and the resistance change indirectly says what kind of gas enters inside. So why we are using metal oxide? Why metal oxides are preferred? So you can see practically we have listed so many types of sensors wherein all metal oxides can be used. And here in chemi-resistor type semiconductors, we use literally, we have used practically different combinations of metal oxides. Okay. So what is the principle, working principle of metal oxides? So I have taken a metal oxide, maybe an type semiconductor. So since it is a metal oxide, there are large or excessive of oxygen atoms sitting on the surface of the metal oxide, and that gives the stability of the compound. As I told you earlier, metal oxides are preferred for their stable nature. Okay, if you have a nitrate film or chloride film, if you keep it open in atmosphere, automatically it changes. The nitrate is removed and automatically it becomes oxide. Whereas if it is already an oxide film, even if the atmospheric oxygen gets deposited or removed, nothing much affects the samples. So it has better stability, and it contains lot of oxygen adsorbed on the surface of the rods. I have shown rods here. So each oxygen tends to hold an electron. It bonds, it forms a bond with a free electron available in the material, sensing element. So because of this, the resistivity of the sensing element increases. So for a metal oxide film, this is resistivity will be very high. It will be in megahertz, sometimes also in gigahertz. It will be very high. So when I allow a reducing gas inside, this reducing gas removes the oxygen from the surface. So the bond between the electron and the oxygen breaks, and the bond forms between oxygen and the reducing gas. Therefore, one electron is left free. So when the number of charge carriers increases, the conductivity of the sample increases. At the same time, the resistivity decreases. So it depends on what kind of gas comes in. If it is a reducing gas, it is going to release an electron. If it is a oxidizing gas, it is going to hold an electron. So the nature of the gas coming inside also decides whether the resistance of the material decreases or increases. Also, the choice of the material also depends. If it is an N-type semiconductor, it depends, it works in a different way. If it is a P-type semiconductor, it works in the just opposite way. Okay, but whatever may be the case, in our case, I say that it releases an electron, so conductivity increases and resistivity decreases. Again, when the test gas is removed and when the normal atmosphere is exposed, automatically the oxygen from the atmosphere tends to bond on the surface holding an electron. And within a fraction of minutes or seconds, the element regains its original resistance. So, when a material is exposed to a test gas, it should respond to the test gas immediately, which is called as response time. When the test gas is removed and the material is exposed to normal condition, it should regain its original resistance. This is called as recovery time. Okay, these both are very important. Okay. So this is the experimental setup what we have in our laboratory. So you have a cylindrical chamber here. Within the cylindrical chamber, I can place my sensing element, and also there are provision to heat the sensing element. Because most of the time, the operating temperature of a metal oxide sensor is little high above the room temperature. So we need a heating element to heat the sensing layer. And also I have gas inlet inside and a provision to remove the gas. This provision is fitted with a rotary pump that ensures the evacuation of the chamber, that ensures that no more traces of disc gas is inside the chamber so that the recovery time can be measured accurately. And the sensing element is produced with two leads, as I shown here. So top layer, I am making contact with the help of silver paste, and bottom also I am making contact with the silver paste. And these two lines are fed into a Keithley multimeter, which reads the resistance changes. As I told you earlier, there can be a decrease in resistance level or an increase in resistance level depending on nature of the gas coming inside and also depending on the nature of the semiconducting sensing layer we are using. So in this graph, it is clearly seen that as the PPM level, PPM stands for parts per million. The PPM level of the test gas, as it increases, you can see that the resistance of the material also increases considerably. So when the PPM is around 10, the resistance is only 300 ohms. Whereas when it reaches around 200 PPM, it is around 425. Whereas when it reaches around 2000 PPM, the resistance increases to 675 roughly. Okay. But again, I'm circling. This is the second cycle to check whether the readings are same or constant. So I am allowing only 20 ppm and nearly more or less the same resistance level is obtained. So I can say that the sensing element works properly. And you can draw a sensitivity versus concentration graph. You can see that as the concentration increases, the sensitivity also gradually increases. So I am taking only one curve in whatever I have shown you. Maybe this particular curve or whatever it may be. So you can see that when the test gas is introduced, I can see that there is a resistance change. The resistance slowly increases, reaches a maximum point, and stays constant. So this time is called as response time. So the sensing element should immediately respond to your test gas. So the response time should be fractions of seconds. Whereas when the test gas is removed and the sensing element is exposed to normal temperature, again, it should regain its resistance. So the conductivity increases, resistivity decreases slowly, and it regains the original resistance. Whatever it had already, it reaches that particular resistance, and the time taken by the sensing element to reach its original resistance is called as recovery time. And when you want to calculate the sensitivity of the element, normally what we do is we check the resistivity of the element in an inert atmosphere. So inert atmosphere is nothing but an atmosphere wherein you use inert gas around the sensing element. So in the previous slide, whatever I have shown, inside this particular chamber, we'll be filling with argon or neon, whatever it may be. We were doing with argon. So we'll fix with argon and we'll close both the sides and we'll read the resistance. This gives you our inert value. And we will be removing the inert gas from inside. Then we'll be purging with our test gas, and that is our R gas value. So in order to find the sensitivity, you have to use this formula. So R gas minus R inert divided by R inert, and that is multiplied by 100 will give you percentage of sensitivity. So these are the various parameters that has to be looked into while purchasing a gas sensor. You have many other parameters, but these are very important. That's why I am projecting it to you. So first one is sensitivity of first gas. Maybe this is carbon monoxide and the value. ppm level at which it is starts sensing the sensitivity of second gas value. So some gas sensors have the ability to sense one or two gases, even more number of gases. There is a device called electrical nose. It is just similar to our nose. Okay, our nose smells different kind of gases, different kind of odors. In the same way, an electrical nose will have a combination of materials, different kind of semiconductor materials. Each material will be sensitive to one or two gases. In that case, it is very easy to detect n number of gases, maybe 10 or 15 gases at a stage. So one device, if it fit, it will be reading or it will be finding out what kind of gases coming inside the room. Okay, so that's why this particular device is capable of sensing both CO and NO2 at a stage. So cross sensitivity must be small. So what is cross sensitivity? In the earlier days, when we are talking through landline, we used to ring, and when we talk, we used to get crossed up. We feel like somebody else is talking like that. We may be feeling. So that is the similar thing happened here. So when I am sensing CO2, I should respond only to CO2. When I'm sensing CO, I should only respond to CO. I should not respond to CO2. That is called as cross sensitivity. That is at the same time responding to two or three gases. So that leads to cross sensitivity, and it should be very, very small. And most of the time they say it doesn't respond. Okay. So as I told you, the response time is important. Response and recovery times are important, and they should be very, very minimum. And the temperature, ambient temperature at which it works should also be minimum. And storage temperature, I cannot make a specific temperature to store the sensor. So it should be working in ambient temperature. And relative humidity with which the sensor can work. If the relative humidity is more, sometimes that may damage the sensor. So relative humidity level, we should note while purchasing a sensor. And operating voltage and operating temperature, both are important. Okay, so here the ambient temperature, it means the operating temperature. Here the operating voltage, so level of voltage that should be given as input. And the withstanding voltage, maximum voltage to which sensor device can withstand. Okay, the specification is given here. And also power consumption, which is a major issue. So it should be very, very less. Low power consumption should be preferred. And dimensions, it should be weightless and it should be easy to carry here and there. So dimensions and weight must be low. So these are the parameters that has to be taken into account while buying a gas sensors. Now we move on to the next section. Why we prefer nanostructured gas sensors? What is special about nanostructures? For studying about this, we should know what is nano. Okay. So what is nano? So you can say that. If I talk nano without introducing Richard Feynman, I won't be doing justice. So it is good to know about him. He is the first person to talk about nano. In one of his lectures, while he was presenting in Caltech University, he used this particular phrase. There is plenty of room at the bottom. And this particular phrase made the scientist to think of what he is saying. Because at that time, all the measurements were in micrometer range and thin films were at its peak. Okay, so the measurements were in micrometer range. Whatever the images they created or studies they included, everything was in only micrometer range. Only after this statement, people started thinking and digging on what is more than a micrometer. If I go down, reduce, when you go inside, what you can see. Then came STM, scanning tunneling microscope, and the invent of STM led to the invent of all other things, TEM or whatever it may be, and also the field of nano emerged. So he is the main reason for nano to come in. So now we will move on to what is nano. It is a prefix. It means 10 power minus 9. So the word prefix stands, it makes you clear that it always goes with something. So nanometer, nano rod, nano flower, nano whatever it may be, nano prism, nano structure, nano science, nanotechnology. So this word nano goes with some other word. Okay, so it is just a prefix. So to understand the dimension of nano, I have given here the human hair. Just think of a human hair. It is 1 lakh nanometers thick. So in order to achieve 1 nanometer size, you have to divide the human hair in its along its thickness 1 lakh times. So it is very, 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 very small and you cannot see with naked eye. And the original definition goes like this. Materials with any one of the dimensions ranging between 0 to 100 nanometers are called nanomaterials. And moreover, at this particular dimension, they exhibit properties that are very, very different from their bulk counterparts. So some scientists also claim that not only the size reduction, but even if the size is little higher than 100 nanometers, if the material has a very different property from their bulk counterparts, then you can claim them as nanomaterials. Is nano new? Not at all. Nano is already available in nature. Everywhere you look around, you can see nanomaterials. But the only thing is that we forget to look at it in a proper way, in a proper angle. So all these materials in nature have nano in them. Okay, for example, butterflies and flowers, the petals of flowers and the structures on the butterfly wings give them beautiful colors. And the lizard legs, or pitcher plant, chameleons change color with the help of nanostructures on their skin. And you have robots, that's okay, the seahorse, where you have nanostructures on their tentacles, and the feathers of birds have nanostructures, and the quail bird, and the eyes of mosquito, and you have lot many more examples, lotus leaf and so on, lot many more examples. And whenever you speak about nano, it is very essential that you know about or you differentiate about nanoscience and nanotechnology. So nanoscience, it deals with the synthesis of material and study the phenomena involved behind the synthesis process. So when you study the science behind the synthesis, you call it as nanoscience. Whereas nanotechnology is the ability to convert the nanomaterials into a technological device. So it can be a robot, nanorobots, or the NEMS, or it can be a targeted drug delivery system. It can be used in food package, wherever it is, in cosmetics, and also in textiles also they are using. So when you use nanomaterials in textiles, you have structural colors, you can produce self-repairing dresses or frame-fighting dresses, you have ultra strength, so heavy. I mean, they have good strength. It is not heavy. It will be light, but they will have good strength. UV protection. You have sensors in them to check the odor. And also, nowadays, there are dresses wherein the heartbeats can also be monitored. Smart textiles. They have circuitry in them so that they can monitor your heartbeat and straight away they can text the values to your family doctor. And you have self-cleaning capability, antibacterial capability, and so on. Again, the next question is, why people focus on nano? So the first point is, large surface to volume ratio leads to more efficiency, smaller size, and lower cost. So when you reduce the size of the material, the amount of material that gets exposed increases than the amount of material inside the particle. Okay, so the volume reduces, whereas surface number of particles on the surface increases. This leads to better efficiency. And again, controlling the size of morphology is very important, because as I told you earlier, when the size is reduced considerably, they exhibit really a very, very different behavior. So their physical, their chemical, their electrical, their electronic, their optical properties change vibrantly. Again, as I told you, the surface to volume ratio increases. There is a correlation between the dimensionality and property of a material. Hence, by changing only a few nanometers in size, I can tune the properties to achieve the better applicability of the product. How surface to volume ratio increases? You can ask me. So I have shown you a cube here. When this cube is divided into four cubes, the amount of material being exposed outside increases. This surface area being exposed outside increases. So I say that more number of particles are being exposed. And you literally know that for a gas sensor, when more number of particles are exposed, that there is more probability for the gas molecules to react with. So they try to make chemical bonding with the surface atoms, and hence there will be more sensitivity. So gas sensors, the nanostructures are preferred. So here I have shown you a few products which we have, samples which we have prepared in our laboratory, one-dimensional growth. So you have, you can see plate-like things or wires. I have grown one-dimensional nanorods and flower-like structures. You can see three-dimensional ball-like structures, spheres with nanorods on the surfaces. So all these things we have prepared, and we have studied their sensitivity. And also we have prepared thin films. This is an ordinary thin film. Okay, the surface is very smooth. This is two-dimensional thin film. Whereas here, you can find nanostructural wall-like arrangements on the surface of the thin films. So these are called as nanostructure thin films. You just imagine. Okay, so when gas molecules come and when they sit on the surface, when they sit on the smooth film, only this much surface and this much material is exposed. Whereas when gas molecules come and they interact with a film, nanostructure film like this, you can see that all the sides of the wall are being exposed. And there is more area for the gas molecules to react with. And naturally, the sensitivity and all other parameters related with the gas sensing also increase. Finally, the efficiency of the gas sensor also increases. That's why we always need a nanostructure material as gas sensing element. Finally, not only acquiring knowledge is important, but also education is only filled up. It will become complete whenever you learn something related to life, actually. So I am projecting two quotes here, my favorite quotes. I think it will be useful for your life. One is said by Dr. LPJ Abdul Kalam, goes like this. அனைத்து பறவைகளும் மழையின் போது தங்களது கூடுகளில் அடையும். ஆனால் பருந்து மட்டும் மழையை தவிர்க்க மழை மேகங்களின் மேலே பறக்கும். சிக்கல்கள் பொதுவானவை, ஆனால் அணுகுமுறை வித்தியாசத்தை ஏற்படுத்துகிறது. So most of the times in our life, we find or we get into different kind of problems. But we try to hide away from the problems, run away from the problems. But instead, if our attitude should change, we should be ready to face the problems and we should solve the problems. And if you change your attitude in such a way to solve all your problems, then I'm sure you will definitely reach greater heights. The second quote is by Lauren Kelly. It goes like this. There is no competition when you are manifesting in your own lane. Okay. So this is what expected from you. When you are into some action, maybe we are students, you are maybe a researcher, or you may be a professor or teacher, never mind. Okay, when you are into some profession, you are supposed to understand and love your profession and make sure that you manifest your own lane. You create your own pathway to go. And how can you create your own pathway? Only by understanding whatever you're reading or whatever you're lecturing. So only then you can manifest your own lane. If you are successful in manifesting your own lane, then there won't be any competition because it's your path. Nobody can certainly win you. Okay, all the best, guys. Thank you. If you have any questions, you can ask.
Thank you, sir, for your nice presentation. Participants, you can unmute yourself to ask the questions to the speaker. There are a few questions in the chat box.
Sir, excuse me, sir. Good afternoon.
Yes, please.
This is Dr.Dhayal Raj from Awardee University.
Yes.
Actually, use of metal oxide based on the resistance is one good method. But is there any, because of the metal oxides being prepared by various methods,
yes.
Do you have any idea about the sensitivity dependence on the synthesis method or different gases?
Yes, sir. Actually, I have prepared nanomaterials in different methods, actually. As I showed you here, we have prepared plate-like structures using reflex method, force condensation method. Here we have prepared wire-like nanostructures using hydrothermal method. And here we have used using solvothermal method, three-dimensional sphere-like things. And also using precipitation method, we have obtained flower-like things. And this is a sillar method where we have used seed layers. On the seed layers, we have deposited flower-like structures on them. So, as you told, the method of preparation, and because of the method of preparation, the morphology obtained also affect the sensitivity to a greater extent because each one showed a different behavior. In fact, we thought that most of the literature that shows that one-dimensional nanostructures, they give much response. But in our case, we saw that one-dimension nanostructures on the surface of the sphere-like structures. Okay, that produced better efficiency when compared to the one-dimensional wires. But maybe what we suggested is that because on the top of this sphere-like structure, we had rod-like projections. Those are also one-dimensional. But the surface area exposed was more in our case. We concluded like that, and that may be the reason for extra sensitivity. And whatever you said is 100% sure. The method of preparation will affect to greater extent because only in hydrothermal or solvothermal routes, most of the times you get one-dimensional structures because of the pressure that comes into it. Whereas in other structures, you always end up with particles or some other structures. So the preparation method has a greater hand in controlling the sensitivity of the material.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes. Chat box.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yes, please.
This is Dr. Subramanian from Pudukottai.
Yes, please.
Sir, what's the exact relative humidity maintained inside the sensing chamber, sir?
Relative humidity to be maintained?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Just a minute. Actually, it depends on the type of gas sensors we are using. I get an echo. Type of gas sensors we are using. So when you purchase a gas sensor, some kind of difficulty, I don't know why I'm getting an echo. Can you please put off your mic? You can listen to it. Just put off your mic. Okay. Good. So, yes, whenever you purchase a gas sensor, here they have given the relative humidity value. And those sensors has to be kept at that particular relative humidity value. So, whenever you prepare a material, depending on the material, the relative humidity value will change. It is not a constant value. If you are having a tin oxide film, it will have a different relative humidity value. If you are having a cobalt oxide or vanadium pentoxide, it will have a different relative humidity value. And of course, the relative humidity value is very important because most of the sensors, they also sense the humidity level around, because being a metal oxide, they tend to absorb moisture. So sometimes the humidity may come into play. So as you told, it is better to check the humidity value and then proceed. So depending on your material, the value has to be predetermined before you do your sensing studies.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another question is, these sensors are actually operated at higher temperatures. Suppose if we go for a commercial application, then we need a particular sensor that should act as act in a room temperature. Suppose the same experiment will be tested in room temperature, what will be the results, sir?
You will have the results, but again, your questions are very broad. Actually, it depends on the material. What you said is 100% true. One of the main drawbacks of metal oxides is the operation temperature. It is really high. As I told you, a little bit higher than room temperature. And this is one of the disadvantages of metal oxide sensors. But again, when you reduce the size to nanoscale, we have achieved with operating temperature around 35 to 40 degrees Celsius. They sense. Actually, the sensitivity level will be little less, but you will have to compromise whether you are going to compromise in operating temperature or the sensitivity. You have to compromise. But if you want really go for operating temperature at room temperature, then you will have to either avoid metal oxides and get into some other sensors, some other types of sensors.
Okay, thank you, sir. In a case, can we use polymeric hybrid forms? The metal oxide
sure, sure.
may be doped with some of the polymers.
Sure, sir. That is what I'm saying. The choice of the material should vary. So whatever you're saying can be tried. Okay. Even now, in case of metal oxides, with the change in morphology, we can reduce so much. The operating temperature from 200, we have reduced considerably to 50, 60. So as you said, if you blend with some kind of polymer or something, the temperature can be very well reduced. And you literally know that polymers don't operate, are not stable at high temperatures. So depending on your use, the choice of the material goes. If the temperature of the surrounding where the sensor is used is very normal, then you can go for a polymer-based material. But for example, if I am going to use my sensor in an industry-based place where the temperature is very high, when you enter some industries, it's in some of the industries, the temperature in the surroundings are literally high. Whenever you enter inside, you feel sweating. In those kind of ambient atmospheres, I think metal oxides are better. So the choice of the material depends on where you use it.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Thanks for your nice presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, there are a few questions in the chat box, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
What kind of sensing elements are usually used in sensors, sir?
Okay. Again, they're using practically different kind of sensors. Actually, mostly metal oxides we are concentrating. But apart from metal oxides, you have also polymer films. You have also organic material films where they can be operated at much lower temperature. And you have, and sometimes they are using also metal nanoparticles for sensing. And again, it depends on what kind of gas you are sensing, and you will have to do your literature survey before choosing the material, what kind of atmosphere and what kind of gas you are going to sense. That is more important.
Next question. Which types of gases are detected using this instrument, sir?
Again, the questions are very broad again. So for example, when I was using vanadium pentoxide, I was measuring ethanol. Okay. When I developed indium oxide, what I have put here, no? We were measuring amine. So the choice of the material and the choice of the gas differs. Okay. So depending on your requirement, you can choose the material and you can choose the gas. If you are going to work for example, I was working with food products, preservation of food products. So I'll have to do my groundwork. What kind of gases you are going to involve with? For example, I say if a fish gets spoiled, amines come out of fish and ethanol is liberated. So I am interested to check the freshness of fish. Then I should choose a material which will sense ethanol. I should produce a material which will sense amine. Okay. So if you are going to choose a different food product or different, maybe the LPG gas or something, then you'll have to do a literature survey wherein you'll have a n number of materials. You have, I have gone through hundreds and hundreds of literatures wherein they say practically all the combinations of metal oxides, they tend to detect so many types of gases. So the choice of the metal material and the choice of the gas is full and fully left to your choice. So any kind of gases can be sensed. Only thing is that the proper combination of the metal oxides must be used.
Sir, in your session, you showed one gas sensing instrument that is common for all the gases, sir.
For all the gases, you can test with that instrument, but because we have arrangements for operating temperature change, everything. But only thing is that how you are going to insert the gas, that is very important. If you are asking me to do some gas which is very explosive or something, and for example, if you are testing something with oxygen or nitrogen, I always have a cylinder or chamber to do that. Even for ethanol, I can evaporate the solution with a little temperature, and I can make the gas flow through the mass flow meter, and I can measure the amount of gas I am inserting. But when you are using a different kind of gas, rare gas, something like that, then you should be double the time careful. So the choice of the gas also depends, but I'm sure most of the gases can be dealt with the apparatus what we have.
Shall we start with one more question, sir? With one more question, we can start by
yes. Yes,
we please. One more session. Okay.
Sir, what types of samples, like the pellets, liquid, or any other specifications, we have to prepare for sensor analysis? What are the advantages of gas sensor compared with other sensors? Other than H or any other gas, we can use for gas sensing.
As I told you earlier, we can use any type of gas for sensing because we have different types of gas sensor for different gases. Okay, we can choose anything. But as you told me, powders, we can make pellets and use as gas sensors. And thin films, in thin film form, you can prepare gas sensors. But I have not come across liquid gas sensors. maybe, no, I haven't come across. Maybe I should check the literature. But for definitely, if it is in a powder form, you can pelletize the powder form and you can use it as gas sensors. And also thin films, definitely you can prepare gas sensors out of that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Any other questions?
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yes, sir. Sister Vinci, you can continue, sister.
Okay, ma'am. Gratitude is the attitude of the noble soul. It must be expressed, communicated, and conveyed in order to exist at all. With these sentiments, I express my deep sense of appreciation and thanks to Dr. Dhayal Raj on behalf of the Department of Physics of Auxilium College for his availability to deliver the talk on metal oxides on gas sensors for the second session of international webinar on sensors and application. You have indeed enlightened us into the deeper understanding of the topic and enthused us to widen our knowledge with great involvement for research. Your inspiring speech and your great interest in research are the sure indications of your significant contribution to the academic community. Thank you, sir, for your clear presentation of the topic on metal oxide gas sensors and your competency to explain with clarity and for your readiness to clear the doubts and questions raised by the participants. Thank you, sir. I also
thank you, sister.
Okay, sir. I also thank Dr. Nisha Santakumari, head of the Department of Physics, and staff who collaborated with her for the organization of the webinar, and for the faculty participants, research scholars, and PG students for their enthusiastic participation in the session. Thank you to one and all.
I request the participants to keep the video on so that we can take some photos. Participants, kindly keep your video on. I request all the participants to keep their video on. Yes, sir. Yes, our sincere thanks to Dr. Dhayal Raj. I also thank the participants. After 20 minutes, after 30 minutes, kindly assemble for the next session, third session at 3:50. I request the participants to join at 3:50 for the last session. Yes, thank you. Thank you, everyone.